They cry with one another. They talk about what's going on. And they're just very upset by the entire thing. They are outraged, not at the real the charges so much that are being brought against Michael, but by the people who are bringing the charges.
Mr. Oxman, is there any sense within the family that it might be Mr. Jackson's behavior that to some degree lends itself to making him a target of these accusations?
There is no question that Michael is a target of accusations. He's been a target since he was 12 years old. He seems to attract this kind of attention, and he lives a different kind of lifestyle from you and I. But then he is a different kind of human being from you and I. His talent is extraordinary. His abilities are extraordinary. If we were to have Michael change in any respect, whatever he changed to would also be a target. So there really isn't anything that Michael can do except to weather the storm.
As we are looking just incidentally at live pictures from Las Vegas of Michael Jackson greeting fans who are coming up to his parked vehicle as it is stuck in traffic there. Let me ask you a few more questions, Mr. Oxman. To your knowledge, has the family discussed what's going to happen to Michael Jackson's children?
We don't have any clue as to what the district attorney is going to do with respect to that or what Child Services was going to do with respect to that. But what I can tell you is that this family is...
With his success and money, Jackson bought a ranch north of Hollywood where he could live and play privately. He called the place Neverland. It would replace the funhouse he never had in childhood. He encouraged young friends to visit him there. Photographers were barred. It was Jackson's secret playground.
He would continually adopt these children, new children, mostly white, Caucasian children, all very young. He would shower them with gifts. He would shower the families with gifts.
Some kids got to spend overnight visits with Jackson. There were reports that he slept with them, but never abused them. It was very odd behavior, but unchallenged, until 1993, when one boy told his father Jackson had sexually abused him. A private detective from Chicago, Ernie Rizzo, was quietly hired by the boy's father to investigate.
I've been an investigator for over 30 years. I've seen child abuse cases for 25 years. I'm from the old school. You're never going to convince me this is the way normal 35-year-old men are supposed to behave. We're talking about a very, very sick boy.
Before Rizzo had finished his probe, stories about Jackson and other children began to surface. Now the LA police wanted to talk to Jackson, but Michael Jackson was in Asia on tour. He sent back a taped message that he was too sick to talk with cops, too sick to finish his tour.
It is time for me to acknowledge my need for treatment in order to regain my health. I realize that completing the tour is no longer possible, and I must cancel the remaining dates. I know I can overcome the problem and will be stronger from the experience. Thank you all for your support and understanding. I will see you soon. I love you all. Goodbye.
Michael Jackson put a team of lawyers and managers to work and checked into an undisclosed clinic claiming he was addicted to prescribed painkillers.
I am not going to discuss where he is. I don't want you to know. I don't want anybody to know.
If and when they decide to prosecute him, and if and when they issue a warrant, we'll respond to the warrant. And the inference that he's fled to avoid prosecution is just ludicrous and not true.
You know, all I see here is people trying to go to bat for Michael Jackson. And all it takes is one man, Michael Jackson. Come on back. It's real simple. Come on back and tell us what you do when you sleep in bed with these children. That's all.
The tabloids were in a frenzy. Even Jackson's own sister, LaToya, held an airport news conference and seemed to turn on him.
Now you stop and you think for 1 second and you tell me, what 35-year-old man is going to take a little boy and stay with him for 30 days and take another boy and stay with him for 5 days? and a room and never leave the room.
Jackson ignored the questions and continued touring, making millions of dollars.
Michael Jackson's career is not ruined. You are talking about a living icon in our society, one of the great performers ever in the history of the world, and he will bounce back and be bigger than ever, I am confident.
The LA DA was not rushing to judgment.
When the investigation is complete, we will then analyze it and determine whether or not it meets our, quote, filing standards, end quote.
While DA Gil Garcetti was cautious, the detective from Chicago was more direct.
Why does this 35-year-old man must sleep with children? Why can't he give them another bed? Why can't they sleep in his bedroom but in another bed? Why must they sleep under the same covers? Can only be one reason.
Michael Jackson eventually agreed to let the police photograph his body. Later, he released a video for the public and his fans.
I have been forced to submit to a dehumanizing and humiliating examination by the Santa Barbara County Sheriff Department and the Los Angeles Police Department earlier this week.
The first thing I remember was seeing him in this poorly shot video complaining and sobbing about how the police had violated him. And already up to that point, America was like, "You're a little weird, son. We don't know how we feel about you."
They served a search warrant on me, which allowed them to view and photograph my body, including my penis, my buttocks, my lower torso, thighs, and any other area that they wanted. The warrant further stated that I had no right to refuse the examination or photographs, and if I failed to cooperate with them, they would introduce that refusal at any trial as an indication of my guilt. It was the most humiliating ordeal of my life. It was a nightmare, a horrifying nightmare. But if this is what I have to endure to prove my innocence, my complete innocence, so be it.
Despite the denials, Jackson did not want his day in court. He was determined to keep his accuser from going public. Coming up next, a deal which ends the criminal charges but may have cost Michael Jackson his audience. December 1993, Michael Jackson's winter of discontent. He's fighting the sexual abuse charges in and out of court.
There have been many disgusting statements made recently concerning allegations of improper conduct on my part. These statements about me are totally false. As I have maintained from the very beginning, I am hoping for a speedy end to this horrifying experience to which I have been subjected.
Despite public pressures and continued stories, the Los Angeles District Attorney refuses to indict Michael Jackson for criminal sexual abuse. The DA says there is insufficient evidence. Suddenly, the lawyers for Jackson and the child make an out-of-court settlement.
He paid $20 million to make it go away, but never convicted in a court of law. Does an innocent person pay $20 million to keep something quiet?
Jackson was immediately seen in public with his old friend, Elizabeth Taylor. He went back to work and convinced Tommy Mottola, the president of Sony Music at the time, to reinvest millions into his career and to issue a new album with an expensive marketing campaign.
But the thing with the record business is that you typically see scumbags are able to have hits because people don't care. They just want good music. Now, he had an album, Invincible, that had one hit on it, maybe two if you count Butterflies. The rest of the album was garbage. Americans didn't like it, they didn't want it, they didn't buy it. And they were smart enough to not be bamboozled by the hype that Sony put out, because Sony promoted the heck out of that album.
Jackson tried to deflect the lingering child abuse stories by marrying a beautiful young woman, Lisa Marie Presley, daughter of Elvis, and like Michael, part of the so-called royalty of pop culture.
There were reports that Lisa Marie and Michael Jackson didn't sleep together on their wedding night, nor any time after.
The marriage lasted just 2 years.
There were reports that there was a settlement given to Lisa Marie upon their divorce, so she would not talk about their relationship and his involvement with young boys.
Michael set about to find another wife.
He was married again to Debbie Rowe, who he employed with a contract to bear him children. There were reports that Michael Jackson showed up in the delivery room and took Prince Michael, the first child, from her hands and said, "Don't get too attached."
Even as his new wife gave him two children, Jackson remained unhappy and stepped up the plastic surgeries.
His nose is falling apart. There are reports that he has to don rubber implants in his nose each morning as some people brush their hair and brush their teeth.
By the summer of 2002, Jackson was traveling the world with his children. He kept their faces behind veils. His musical career was slumping, so he attacked longtime friend and former Sony Music president Tommy Mottola, calling him a racist. He turned for support to Al Sharpton and his Brooklyn-based civil rights pressure group.
That was really ridiculous. I mean, Michael was looking for a scapegoat. Tommy, by the way, used to be married to a black woman, Mariah Carey. So to throw racism at him, it becomes a little harder stick, you know.
In the winter of 2003, Jackson lost the California civil case brought by his former promoter, Marcel Avram. The court award may reach $5 million. A second case involving a former business manager alleged Jackson owes $13 million in back pay. That case is being tried in a London court. The National Enquirer publishes a book it believes will be his epitaph. It's called Freak. Meanwhile, Jackson suddenly agrees to tell his story to a British TV reporter. Some believe he does it because he needs the money and the exposure. Coming up, Freak or Fantasy Man? Can Jacko moonwalk back to glory? When Michael Jackson hung his child over the balcony of his hotel suite in Germany, some people believed it was a desperate attempt to regain the spotlight.
He's so used to being a superstar that there may be a moment where he's been so far out of the spotlight for 10 years that he can't handle it, and he does something just to get everyone just to look at him again.
Jackson critics like attorney Gloria Allred tried to have authorities remove Jackson's three children from his care. But once again, Jackson prevailed in court. Chicago private eye Ernie Rizzo believes there is a double standard in the legal system, and if this story had played out in any other town, there might have been a very different ending.
He's got some deep, dark, hidden sickness. Hollywood. Had this not been in Hollywood, it would never have happened. When you're in Hollywood, everything seems to go.
This is a guy who was completely open with all his eccentricities, and it just began to snowball into more and more weird stories that the public was able to believe, and really murdered his career.
The only thing steeper than his rise was his precipitous fall. Thus you have Michael Jackson falling from the pinnacle of fame to little more than a sideshow freak.
Come so far from the cutest little black boy in America. It was such a wholesome family thing, and we've gotten so far away from that. I don't expect the story to end well at all.
Now that you know a little bit about his past, up next, a special charge with multiple counts of sex abuse involving a young boy. Hollywood at Large correspondent Diane Diamond has the inside track on this explosive story. We'll have her exclusive interview with the district attorney investigating Jackson. But first, Diane.
Is this the mugshot seen around the world? Prisoner number 621785, a.k.a. Michael Joseph Jackson. The accompanying booking sheet has these facts: race black, sex male, height 5'11, weight 120, age 45. He was processed, fingerprinted, and his defense team put up the $3 million bail. He immediately flew back to Las Vegas, Nevada. That's where I guess he will remain quite a day here in Santa Barbara, Vinny.
What a day, Diane. Now, before we get to Diane's exclusive interview, let's take a look at Diane's special report on the Jackson saga.
I am Peter Pan.
He himself says that he has the heart of Peter Pan. I think maybe he's got the mind of Peter Pan, too. Grown men don't sleep with little boys that aren't their children.
The basis for this investigation regarding Mr. Jackson involves allegations of child molestation, 288A of the California Penal Code.
The king of pop, Michael Jackson, turned himself in to Santa Barbara authorities today to surrender to face the child molestation allegations.
Mr. Jackson has been booked into the county jail. He has since been released. He has posted the bail, and he has been given an arraignment date of January 9th.
These charges are categorically untrue. He looks forward to getting into a courtroom as opposed to any other forum and confronting these accusations head on.
But for now, it's a case of history repeating. It was 10 years ago Michael Jackson was hounded by rumors and accusations of child sexual abuse.
Back in 93, Jackson had this thing of taking a child, and he made no bones about it. He'd sleep with him all night, and then he would give hundreds of thousands of dollars to the parent.
Private Detective Ernie Rizzo was hired by the first accuser's family.
Yeah, when I investigated Michael Jackson, it was very strange that he would only be interested in 10, 11, 12-year-old boys.
TheSmokingGun.com posted the boys' shocking sworn statement.
I think Michael Jackson, according to this document, wanted to turn the relationship and did turn the relationship into something that the boy didn't, which was a homosexual relationship with a young boy.
In 1994, the king of pop paid away his problem in a secret multi-million dollar out-of-court settlement. After getting the money, the boy refused to testify in court. The possibility of filing criminal charges vanished.
It was a nightmare, a horrifying nightmare. But if this is what I have to endure to prove my innocence, my complete innocence, so be it.
Earlier this year, ABC aired a British documentary, Living with Michael Jackson. He told interviewer Martin Bashir young boys often sleep with him in his bed.
Is that really appropriate for a man, a grown man, to be doing that?
Why can't you share your bed? The most loving thing to do is to share your bed with someone.
There's no question that this is a statement that can be used against him in a court of law.
In this particular case, we have a cooperative victim in this particular proceeding.
While the case against Michael Jackson picks up momentum, his fortune is reportedly gone. His career may be too. CBS TV postponed a special originally scheduled for next Wednesday. No word yet on how this latest scandal will affect sales of his just released CD.
I think Michael Jackson has flaunted his pedophilia one too many times. I think he's got a problem this time.
Oh, the problem this time, of course, is that criminal charges have been lodged against the superstar for the very first time. Now, how many charges we don't know, but we do know that each of them carries a maximum 8 years in prison. I got to sit down with a top law enforcement official in Santa Barbara here in this case for an exclusive interview with Court TV. Listen now to District Attorney Tom Sneddon. You won't forget what he told me. What about this family of this child? Do they realize the firestorm that will erupt? Are they worried about their safety?
They're very much aware of the implications of cooperating with law enforcement.
They're that adamant. They're that focused on taking this case forward.
I don't want to leave that characterization because that's unfair. That there's some kind of vindictiveness involved here, or fearlessness involved, or retribution. I think that's an unfair characterization.
they've cooperated with us, and they're aware of the risks involved, and they've still cooperated with us.
And they still want to go ahead.
Yes, and so, I mean, I think it would be really unfair to be talking about these people as if they want to get even with Michael Jackson or something like that. I think my experience generically with child molest victims and the families involved mm-hmm. in child molest, it's a terrible thing for the family. And there's a tremendous amount of issues involved with not only the parents but the children in the best of situations, putting aside Michael Jackson. Mm-hmm. And I don't find this to be, in that sense, any different than any other case. There are difficulties. It's tough. It's emotional, and I just see the people involved are not any different than most all the cases this office gets when there's child victims.
Does this family want a monetary settlement?
I think you have to understand the law in California has changed since the last case, so that whereas in the 1993-94 case, a child victim had the right not to testify if they chose not to. And could still have a civil settlement. The law has been changed now so that that's not correct. I mean, if you take a civil settlement, you don't have that privilege not to testify anymore.
You still could be compelled to testify.
And compelled to testify.
1993-94, we both know the young boy involved. He's now in his early 20s. Does he play a role in this case? Could he be called as a behavior witness or something against Michael Jackson?
Under California law, we're entitled to put in what they call other evidence, if you have it, involving other victims.
There is an affidavit from that original accuser that we've all seen online. Would that perhaps play a part in
this
case?
It's not admissible. It's hearsay. I mean, the only kind of evidence that you're allowed to put in is other acts evidence that that somebody will come in and testify to so that the other side has a chance to cross-examine. That's what's required. That's one of the requirements. So it doesn't become just rank hearsay. Otherwise, you just could bring anybody off the street to say, oh, this happened. Mm-hmm. I heard a third-hand hearsay, which is totally unfair to anybody.
Great work. Thanks, Diane. We'll be seeing more of Diane Diamond in her exclusive interview when Hollywood at Large returns. Welcome back. We've got more of Diane Diamond's exclusive interview with the DA who's leading the Jackson investigation. You'll hear what he has to say about a veiled threat against him. But first, it's time to check in with A.J. Hammer and the Smoking Gun Hot Sheet for the latest in other celebrity news. Hi, A.J.
Hey, Vinny.
So who's making headlines this week?
Well, there's actually big news in the Phil Spector case. He was officially charged.
Man who will prosecute the Michael Jackson case. His nickname in Santa Barbara is Mad Dog. Is Michael Jackson out to get him?
After the 1993-94 investigation, Michael Jackson released the History album.
Yes.
You're smiling. There's a song called D.S. Your initials, of course, are T.S. It says, they want to get my ASS, dead or alive. You know, he really tried to take me down by surprise. I bet he missioned with the CIA. He don't do half of what he say. Dom Sheldon is a cold man. Now that's not Tom Sneddon, but that's pretty darn close. This song was written about you.
That's what some people say.
And then you hear gunshots.
I've been told that at the end there's a gunshot that's barely audible.
But oh, I think it's pretty
okay.
Audible.
I have not listened to it. I
know
you've got more important things going on in my life than to listen to a song written by a guy who's everybody calls Jacko Wacko.
On the liner notes, opposite the lyrics about you, I maintain these are obviously about you. There's this picture. There's a picture of a bound child, head wrapped like a mummy, almost like the wrists are slit. This appears to be a message to you.
No, I wouldn't even get into that. I mean, Diane, I haven't listened to the song.
I haven't listened to the lyrics. I haven't looked at the thing.
That's pretty creepy, though, isn't it?
I'm not, you know, I have my life and what I do, and I do my job, and anybody who thinks I've spent 10 years sitting here waiting to do something for Michael Jackson just has not got a clue. For anybody to think that I'm doing this for political reasons is totally poppycock, because I'm not running for re-election. I'm retiring in 3 years, and I've been successful. I have a good career. I'm not worried about getting another notch on my belt. This is a case. It came down the line. It's my responsibility. It's a serious case. It deserves serious discretion to be used. When you file charges against somebody for a crime, whether it's a felony or a misdemeanor, they can't get that back. Even if they're acquitted, they can't get it back. Mm-hmm. People still think there's something there, you know, there's smoke to fire. This thing with Michael Jackson, it's a case that came in. The sheriff and I have committed that we're going to handle it like any other case to the extent that we can. No special treatment one way or the other, and that's the way we view it. It's part of our jobs. But to think that, for anybody to think this is something that we're doing because he wrote some song about me or something happened, you know, 10 years ago, it's just not true. It's just simply
when we return, Diane Diamond will be back with more of her exclusive reporting on the Michael Jackson case.
Manuel and his family with lavish presents. Jackson had other young friends, including Sean Lennon and Corey Feldman, who gave the King of Pop his phone number on the set.
Welcome back to Hollywood at Large, a roller coaster in the Michael Jackson case, culminating, for now at least, in his surrender. What does it all mean? Well, joining us from Santa Barbara again, Hollywood at Large correspondent Diane Diamond, and in New York, noted criminal defense attorney Mickey Sherman. Diane, I want to start with you. You've owned this story for 10 years. What was it like to see the King of Pop in handcuffs today?
Oh, Vinny, that makes me sound old that I've been at this for 10 long years, but you're right. It seems sort of like I just left here and I just picked the story back up, but it was surreal. I have to tell you, when I saw it, I caught my breath. I counted the steps he took up to the door, 5, 6, 7, 8, and I thought those had to be the longest, most humiliating steps of his life.
Mickey Sherman, there's someone else involved here. It's an alleged victim. Will this young boy have to testify in court against Michael Jackson?
I think he will. The Sixth Amendment guarantees that you have a right to confront the people who are testifying against you. In certain circumstances, they can use some videotape things, but I think that this young man is going to have to come to court, and I have to believe that he has weighed that, and his parents and his therapists and all his people have weighed that decision in before he came forward, so I think he's probably going to be ready.
Diane, high-profile attorney Mark Garagos has his hand in every case, but some think that he may have been working on this case as early as March. Is there any truth to that?
That's what I'm hearing. I've talked to several sources, both here in Santa Barbara and in Los Angeles, people who are familiar with the case. And Garagos has been on it for several months. The mother came forward, talked to one lawyer who referred her to a second lawyer. They then got her in touch with the Santa Barbara Police Department. And Michael Jackson knew something was brewing for many months. And that's when he brought Garagos on. I also hear that he was trying to engage Tom Mesereau at one time, Robert Blake's attorney, but Mesereau turned him down, said he was too busy.
Interesting. Mickey, now Mark Garagos is taking over a case. A lot of bad publicity for Michael Jackson today. Seems like he's starting a little bit behind. What does he have to do?
Yeah, a little bit. Well, he's never going to catch up as far as making an 11-playing field. I mean, you know, the lead in every TV show tonight and for the next couple of nights is going to be that picture of him in cuffs. And then we're going to see that bizarre mugshot on every paper in the world tomorrow. So he's never going to be able to really kind of even it up. All he did is what he did today, which is the right thing. Come out, Michael Jackson surrendered. We're not asking for special treatment. Give him a fair trial, and I'm not going to take any questions. And that's where he's got to start this thing.
Now, from watching that press conference, it seems that law enforcement thinks there may be other victims out there. There might be other victims alleged in this case itself. Can you kind of straighten that all out for us?
Well, in this particular, the latest accusation, there's only one, a young boy, 12 years old, a cancer patient. His mother says that she was had almost lost him, and he got to know Michael Jackson, and that's one victim. Yes, I think that authorities believe that there are other Michael Jackson victims, and they publicly called on them to call up the sheriff's department and let them know what they know. They'll come out and investigate. So You never know. They may really have their hands full here.
Now, Mickey, Michael Jackson had time to negotiate his surrender today. Did he receive special treatment because he's a celebrity and he's Michael Jackson?
Honestly, I don't think so. I think that, you know, the only thing that was special is the fact that he got there in a G3 instead of a Chevy Camaro. But basically, once he got there, they put the cuffs on him. They didn't treat him any different. He walked in. You know, he had the bond money ready, which is not, you know, atypical. The only thing special, I thought, was in the negative, and that is that he apparently was subjected to some kind of video taping and some other still photography, which the authorities indicated that they're going to release to the public. That's special, but it's bad special.
All right. Well, thank you both for your analysis. Our thanks to Mickey Sherman and to Diane Diamond, who'll be right back with me. We've got more of her exclusive interview plus predictions on what's next for Michael Jackson. Stay with us.
Would Vendetta be better described by a photograph of Michael Jackson? As NBC's Carl Quintanilla reports, the answer may be contained in the lyrics of one of Jackson's songs.
You may not know who this man is, but rest assured, Michael Jackson does.
I can assure you that within a very short period of time, there will be charges filed against Mr. Jackson, multiple counts.
Tom Sneddon, so tough a prosecutor, his old nickname is Mad Dog.
Get over here and get checked in.
A prosecutor who, 10 years ago, went after Jackson in a similar case, had the singer's genitals photographed as evidence.
We look at what's available to us as to whether or not we should ethically, as prosecutors, bring charges against individuals.
Even earned Jackson's wrath in the form of this song.
Got two people at odds here legally, but also people who clearly don't like each other.
In fact, some are now questioning Sneddon's timing.
Jackson himself, I believe, has said that this was all done to try to ruin his new CD that was coming out or whatever it is he's doing. Like, the sheriff and I really are into that kind of music, but...
Some even say this time it's personal.
I could tell you BS. But, you know, that doesn't going to change people's observations. And I think the other way is if you want to check with people who know me, they know better than that.
Officials who've worked with Sneddon in the past agree.
I don't think that that has much impact on Tom. I think the impact on Tom is the nature of the charges.
After 24 years, Sneddon says he won't run for re-election in 2006. That's enough time for a case that has all the makings of a bitter showdown. Carl Quintanilla, NBC News, New York.
About that song, the liner notes to the 1995 album in which it appears lists its title as DS and lists the lyrics as Dom Sheldon is a cold man, not Tom Sneddon is a cold man. But as anybody knows who's ever tried to figure out what Jackson is actually singing in his hit Billie Jean, what's in the official lyrics and what's on the record are not necessarily the same thing. When did the vendetta actually begin and who started it? It's hard to answer that one, not just because in his song Jackson linked Sneddon to the Ku Klux Klan, not just because in an official profile of Sneddon refers to the song, not just because just this afternoon Jackson's spokesman issued a statement in which he referred to Sneddon's charges as the big lie against Michael Jackson. Now, it's hard to answer that one because in any vendetta worthy of the name, after a while it no longer matters who started it. Let's recap the countdown stories briefly. Number five, He is suspect 621785, free after $3 million in bail. In the energy bill.
Investigators do a yeoman's job for them. And despite the financial differences, this guy seems like he's ready to, you know, roll up his sleeves and meet this guy in court. In fact, Tom Sneddon will probably be the lead attorney when it does get to trial.
Very quickly, when do you think we're going to have this trial?
Well, let's see, the arraignment is January 9th, so I don't know, probably later next year.
Okay, that's it for this week. Diane Dime and I thank you for watching Hollywood at Large on CourtTV, the only network that can do Hollywood justice.
Hi, everyone. This was a surrender unlike any other. First in Las Vegas, Jackson boarded a private jet with his attorney, Mark Garagos, for the flight back home to California. But in case you were wondering whether Jackson still has money, there wasn't just one, but two jets. The first plane landed, Jackson wasn't on it. Why? It was a decoy. Soon after, a second plane landed, this one with K.O.P., the King of Pop, on board. A short while later, Jackson, his hands cuffed behind his back, was brought into the Santa Barbara County Jail. He was booked, photographed, and that famous hand, often covered in a sequin glove, was fingerprinted. The booking process took approximately 30 to 45 minutes, was completed without incident. Mr. Jackson's people were very cooperative throughout this process, and the Sheriff's Department would like to forward their appreciation for that cooperation at this point in time. Jackson's surrender was arranged by his attorney, Mark Garagos.
Michael is here. He's come back specifically to confront these charges head on. He is greatly outraged by the bringing of these charges. He considers this to be a big lie.
After posting $3 million bail, Jackson left the county, headed back to the airport and his private jet. Back on the streets of Las Vegas tonight, his car swarmed. Michael Jackson will be back in court for an arraignment on January the 9th. Let's turn now to NBC's Mark Mullen, who is outside the Santa Barbara County Jail and was on hand when Michael Jackson turned himself in just hours ago. Mark?
Mike, let's begin, if we can, Dan, back in Las Vegas, because what a scene that was that you just showed us just a little while ago. I mean, how odd is this? Michael Jackson, many would have thought, once he got back on that private jet, went back to Las Vegas, would have simply gotten into a car and disappeared as quickly as he could from public eye. Basically, what ended up happening is he got into an SUV, he started taking off down a road. Abruptly, it made a U-turn and went straight into the middle of the Las Vegas Strip, where he began greeting all these fans from inside the car. He was showing the V sign, he was shaking hands, and not until, let me see, I'll check my watch, just until about 6 minutes ago did he actually pull into a hotel and spa in Henderson, Nevada. This scene, though, that you're seeing right here is a much different scene and a lot less sober than that which was taking place in Santa Barbara in this jail behind me earlier today. This is where he arrived in handcuffs and was brought right into that building to be fingerprinted and formally processed in booking transaction number 621785.
Mr. Jackson has been booked into the county jail. He has since been released. He has posted the bail, and he has been given an arraignment date of January 9th, 2004, at 8:30 a.m. in Santa Barbara Superior Court.
Dan, I can also add to that that a statement was published just a little while ago by the DA that also says that we can anticipate formal charges being made against Michael Jackson sometime after Thanksgiving, sometime after 1 week from today. Back to you.
Mark Mullen, thanks very much. The latest allegations against Jackson come as reports of even more bizarre behavior surfacing, with the release of a videotape of Jackson's bedroom at Neverland Ranch. Extras Jerry Penicoli has seen the tape and has details. Jerry, the tape shows a secret room?
Yes, Dan, that's correct. You know, as if the story can get any more bizarre, but it has proven to do just that. We've obtained, our show Extra has obtained a videotape, which you will see tonight, or you may have already seen tonight, depending on your time zone, that shows explicitly a secret room that is off of Michael Jackson's bedroom. Now, let me just paint the picture, first of all, before I even explain to you what is in the room. This videotape was obtained by a British documentarian, and it was shot by a former staff member who worked at the Neverland Ranch. Now, let me just go blow by blow what you'll see in the room. The room contains, first of all, you picture a walk-in closet, and then in the back of the walk-in closet is a panel. The secret panel will either slide or flip to reveal a 10-foot room. Inside that room are pictures of underage boys. There's a shrine to Macaulay Culkin. There's a picture of Shirley Temple. There are some other unknown boys. Then there are shelves upon shelves of videotapes. Now, I cannot sit here and tell you what's on those videotapes. They could be his video collection of his concerts. They could be his blockbuster movies. I don't know. They could be something else altogether. Now, what's perhaps even more astonishing is up a stairwell, again, only accessible through Michael Jackson's bedroom, is a stairwell which leads to a children's room, a bedroom, if you will. Cluttered and littered on the stairwell going up to the room are rag dolls and toys and all kinds of goodies. And then you get into the room. It's a windowless kids' room, and you have a bed there. Very simple, with Peter Pan sheets. But then there are toys upon toys all over the room. There's video games. There's all kinds of things. A Mickey Mouse phone, a veritable children's fantasy. So it is, it's quite shocking.
Jerry Pinacoli, thanks a lot for that.
Hey, Dan, let me add one more thing. What makes it perhaps most astonishing is that, you know, most people would say, well, he's got kids. That room could actually be a little anteroom for one of his kids. Yeah. Well, the problem with that is we're told that this videotape was shot in 1994 before Michael Jackson ever had any kids of his own.
For those of you wondering where there is a shrine to Macaulay Culkin in this world, apparently we have found out. Jerry Pinacoli, thank you very much.
Sir.
Appreciate it.
Okay.
Once again, the headline, Michael Jackson has surrendered to police and posted $3 million bail. Today he's back in Las Vegas. A lot to get to tonight. Let's bring in our legal panel, Stacey Honowitz, prosecutor working in the Sex Crimes and Child Abuse Unit for Broward County, Florida. Criminal defense attorney Jan Ronis, former prosecutor Bill Fallon, who specialized in child abuse prosecutions, and criminal defense attorney Jane Weintraub. All right, Jane, $3 million. Seem appropriate to you?
Yeah, it does. I mean, I think it's probably not much more than a standard bond would be on this kind of a case.
Stacey, I would think that for most people, the bond would be a little bit lower.
Well, I'm not shocked. I wasn't shocked at what the bond amount was. I think that probably Jane's right. I mean, for these kind of charges and what the penalties are that they carry, I wasn't shocked at a $3 million bond at all.
Jan, any problem? Anyone have any problem with the fact that he was cuffed? Jan?
Well, I mean, he's, you know, going to be treated like any other criminal defendant. And if they didn't cuff him and they had escorted him into the jail, unlike other defendants, then they'd be, you'd be hearing everybody cry that he's being treated differently. So that doesn't surprise me. I mean, had they arrested him in Las Vegas, they would have cuffed him there and brought him a long way in cuffs.
Bill Fallon, you were concerned about these authorities after their first press conference. Has a day gone by reassured you a little bit that things may move a little more smoothly?
Well, I think they'll move more smoothly because the sheriff's department's the speaker. As you know, Dan, the sheriff's department looks like they're putting movie stars out there now, and I think it should keep that. That DA better stay in the background. I got calls from several prosecutors who were saying, serious case, serious charges, let's just run it like professionals, because this is going to play into the defense's argument that maybe they didn't even try to interview Jackson. I don't know if that happened, and maybe this is just some, as we hear, vendetta. Let's concentrate on the victimization of this kid and be professional about it.
Let's talk about whether Michael Jackson's children should be taken away from him. Let me read you two statutes in California that relate to this issue. First, child molestation statute. Any peace officer may, without a warrant, take into temporary custody a minor in immediate danger of physical or sexual abuse. And the court can take control of someone when the child has suffered or there is a substantial risk that the child will suffer serious physical harm inflicted non-accidentally upon the child by the child's parent or guardian. Bill Fallon, any reason at this point to think that proceedings should move forward to remove these children from Michael Jackson's care?
Well, I think that there will be people who will file certain things, as you know, Dan. But I would tell you, certainly in Massachusetts and around the country, just because somebody is charged with something, we couldn't get people, if they were charged with abusing one of the children, we couldn't get our departments to look at the other children and whether they're protected. Unless there's some information that in fact alleges and has some credibility, alleges that he's doing something untoward towards his kids. I think it sounds nuts to say he's molested some kids, but we shouldn't look into the, to his own kids.
Very, very different in California.
Go ahead, Jan.
Yeah, in California, Child Protective Services would likely move in and take these kids. I mean, it's very common. In fact, it's almost the rule in any case involving allegations of misconduct. Now, I imagine, you know, this investigation, I understand, had been going on some time. Michael Jackson's been aware of it. Mr. Garagos has been aware of it. I suspect they made arrangements to get the children out of the house to avoid any thought that CPS may come in and take these kids from. So I think this was probably arranged in advance.
Jane Weintraub, I mean, do you think that someone should be making an effort, I mean, to at least investigate this? Or
I'm sure they have. What Jane started to touch on that's interesting is that these allegations were not from yesterday. They were not placed imminently in any danger, or something would have happened already. Remember, from what I've read, they were supposed to arrest Michael Jackson before Halloween. We're a month later, so obviously nothing happened to the children, and that's the best evidence. That's number one. And number two, Dan, I think that the statute means if the child that was molested, in other words, if the victim of the allegation were one of his own, then it would be a rush to get the kid out of there. But that's not what the case is.
That's a good point. Stacey, let me ask you this. Mm-hmm. The DA and the authorities had said, as Jane points out, that they were considering going in a lot earlier, but you know they had a lot of other things to do, and as a result, they didn't execute the search warrant. They talked about all these people who were in town. I mean, doesn't that seem a little bit odd that this is, you know, a crime where they're sending in 60 or 70 people to execute a search warrant, and they're saying, you know what? Well, we really couldn't get around to it until yesterday. We've been thinking about it though for a while.
Boy, you know what, Dan? You have no idea, and I don't think the general public, and I don't think anybody knows what was going on prior to them going in with the warrant. You don't know what the substance of the investigation was, and you know that in several investigations, they have to wait. There's information that they're waiting for.
But that's not what they said. They said the reason they waited to execute the warrant was because they had other matters to deal with. I wish I had the quote here. But basically, they were saying that there were other things they were dealing with. It didn't sound like it related to this investigation.
Well, I don't know what other matters they were dealing with, but obviously they didn't think that it was so important that they go in right away. You know, this like Jane said and Jan said, this case has been going on for a while. It's not like they got news about a molestation. This has been ongoing for a couple of months. So obviously they felt that they could wait a little bit. They didn't have to rush in, and we don't know what the information was.
But
they
Jan,
needed to wait till they could have
78. Go ahead, Bill. Jan, that says to me that they don't view Michael Jackson as any sort of imminent threat, and as a result, it seems to me that he shouldn't lose his kids then.
Well, but you remember, in fact, that fits right not in his house.
No, could I just...
Bill Thumb.
But what happened yesterday was when he gave that, which is why I think he should have shut his mouth, to say that it was trick-or-treat time,
yeah, right,
and that's exactly what he said. Right. It's trick-or-treat, so we can't go to Never Never Land because everybody's taking care of trick-or-treat in our town. If that wasn't the most offensive minimization of the seriousness of this case, I think if I were them, I'd put that right on the stand if there's any child protective hearing and saying this DA thought trick-or-treat was more important than these kids. And I'm going to tell you, that's going to play out in many ways. It's going to play out in some judge even saying that he didn't have to put up that much bail. You can say all you want about investigation, Stacey, and I agree with you.
Right.
The public doesn't know, but this should have been handled a month ago.
Panel's going to stick around. Let me take a quick break here. Coming up, you may not be familiar with the prosecutor filing charges in the case. Michael Jackson knows exactly who he is. He's even written a song about the guy. And Michael Jackson, the business. Is he filthy rich or broke? He's made millions, but has he blown it all? Stay with us.
Jackson lives. Was there a result? Do we know anything? Remember in Peterson, we saw the police taking out bags and bags of evidence. Do we know what was taken from Neverland?
Well, don't forget there was more than just Neverland search. There were two other warrants served in Southern California at two film businesses. That I know a little bit about. The two film businesses, there were films taken from the owners there. One man was quoted as saying, the authorities told me not to say anything about it, but there were videos of Michael Jackson with various children at various locations. So I'm sure this might be used as an identifier just to put Jackson with this accuser. Now, as for Neverland, no, we don't know what they took. We know that they wrapped up their search like 14 hours after it began. They had, I'm sure, an eye on the computers. I'm told maybe some personal letters they were looking for between the accuser and him, photographs. And, of course, Michael Jackson is an avid video nut. He likes to take a lot of video. So I'm sure they were looking at that, too.
Hey, Diane, you got an exclusive interview with the district attorney's office. Tell me about that.
Right. Well, Tom Sneddon does not talk to the media very often. He likes to do his job and go home, and he's real big on a softball team, etc. But he did agree to sit down and talk with me, and he talked about so many things. And one that really stuck out in my mind was when they went to Neverland Ranch 8:30 Monday morning, they knocked on the door. They did not only had a search warrant, they had an arrest warrant in hand, and he told me we were ready to put the handcuffs on him right then and there.
As a matter of fact, Diane, let's go to a clip of your interview with the DA. Take a listen.
Okay.
You know, I have my life and what I do, and I do my job, and anybody who thinks I've spent 10 years sitting here waiting to do something for Michael Jackson just has not got a clue. For anybody to think that I'm doing this for political reasons is totally poppycock, because I'm not running for re-election. I'm retiring in 3 years. And I've been successful. I have a good career. I'm not worried about getting another notch on my belt. This is a case. It came down the line. It's my responsibility. It's a serious case. It deserves serious discretion to be used.
Joining us also, everyone, is a Jackson family friend. Steve Manning is with us tonight. Steve, I know you heard that bite from the district attorney.
Hi, Nancy. How are you?
Hi. Thank you for being with
us,
Steve. Do you think this is some sort of a grudge match between a DA who was robbed of a conviction 10 years ago?
Well, you know, Nancy, it seems very strange. Michael's CD has already come out yesterday. The timing seems very coincidental. And I like to talk about the Neverland situation. Anybody who goes to Neverland wouldn't want to leave. So why would someone be held kidnapped? That's preposterous, I would say. I mean, it's ridiculous to say he was holding people by kidnapping. It doesn't make any sense. Neverland is a truly fantasy place that if someone gets the opportunity to go to Neverland one day, you don't want to leave. I had the opportunity to be there many, many times, and it's a wonderful place to stay there on vacation.
Well, as a matter of fact, Steve, Jermaine Jackson, of course, family member, the brother of Michael Jackson, and of course his advocate, called in to CNN today. Take a listen to this, Steve.
It's not eccentric. We had an incredible, wonderful childhood, and what they're doing is bringing him down with the very thing that he loved, his children and family. My brother is about peace. They don't know us, but this will reveal itself. But I am sick and tired of everybody saying these things about my family. And we will fight, and we will stand up. And everybody that knows this family around the world will support us, because at the end of the day, this is nothing but a modern-day lynching.
And, Steve, I've got to agree. If this young boy is not telling the truth, this is a modern-day lynching. However, if he is telling the truth, this is one of the most heinous crimes on the law book. But please, just give me this much, Steve.
Yes,
when Jermaine says, when Jermaine says his brother is not eccentric, hello, do you agree that Michael isn't a tiny bit eccentric?
Well, of course, he's a creative person, Nancy. All creative people are eccentric.
Well, I agree with that, but that certainly doesn't make him a child molester. I agree with
you. Of course not. Let me say something about that. First of all, Jermaine was very, very upset today. There have been many people who have come on these TV shows over the last couple of days, and it's been a frenzy of press. They don't know the family. They don't know Michael. And that's why he's very upset about people speaking about the family. First of all.
Well, that's a point well taken. We're going to explore that and a lot more when we come back. Everyone, Steve Manning has spent time with Michael Jackson over the past 48 hours. He was with him the entire day yesterday when this entire story broke. Also with us on the scene is CourtTV's Diane Diamond. Stay with us.
It's personal.
I can tell you BS, but, you know, that that's going to change people's observations. And I think the other way is if you want to check with people who know me, they know better than that.
Officials who've worked with Sneddon in the past agree.
I don't think that that has much impact on Tom. I think the impact on Tom is the nature of the charges.
After 24 years, Sneddon says he won't run for re-election in 2006. But that's enough time for a case that has all the makings of a bitter showdown. Carl Quintanilla, NBC News, New York.
So Jan Ronis, does this come in? Meaning, does the defense make some sort of motion, make some sort of effort to include this prosecutor's alleged bias?
Sure. I think it's pretty outrageous he made that comment. He obviously has a personal interest in this. The defense can make a motion to recuse the district attorney's office and bring in the attorney general's office to prosecute the case. You know, it kind of reminds me, it would be like, you know, it's so unusual, the district attorney prosecuting a case himself. It'd be like Joe Torre going out in the World Series and pitching for the Yankees because he thought his team wasn't doing very well. So it's unusual, and they may recuse him from handling the case, his entire office.
Bill, go ahead.
I'd be amazed if they recused him. I would say that it's a good argument. I might be arguing that in the end to the jury, but you don't want to let too much in relative to
that
prior allegations.
That gets to the jury, Bill? You're able to argue that to the jury, that he wrote a song about Tom Sneddon?
Oh, no. You can certainly argue if a defense attorney can put on that a prosecutor is showing some kind of bias. For instance, it'd be his whole thing that he felt he got away, that he wrote about him. But again, that could be a twin-edged sword for Jackson here, so I'm not sure he's going to do it. He will be on the case whether anybody likes it or not.
Can I ask Bill one question?
Yeah, please.
In his 22 years or 24 years that he was a prosecutor, head of the unit, did he ever prosecute the same defendant twice?
Oh, I love it.
That the prosecutor knew you? I mean, the defendant knew you before?
Stacey, I actually love that, and I think that's appropriate. What I didn't like was yesterday when he said, I put this baby to bed 10 years ago. I didn't think about it once. I couldn't prosecute. I thought that was as close to a bold-faced lie that I've ever heard. Any prosecutor who thinks there's a child molester out there, which he clearly did when you look at what he did, photographing him before and things like that, and he just couldn't go forward, said the law was changed. It seems to me as disingenuous at a minimum, and I wish you wouldn't do that because I think it gives prosecutors a bad name. Say, look, he was a bad guy then. I had to let it die,
Bill,
but I never forget a prosecutor.
This is a guy who has more than 70 agents to search the
to give to help children all over the world. It is of loving children of all ages and races. It is of gaining sheer joy from seeing children with their innocent and smiling faces. It is of enjoying through them the childhood that I missed myself. If I am guilty of anything, it is of believing what God said about children. Suffer little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. In no way do I think that I am God, but I do try to be God-like in my heart.
Michael Jackson speaking out, and that was before this latest search warrant and arrest. Welcome back to Larry King Live. I'm Nancy Grace from CourtTV, and for Larry tonight, thank you for being with us. Diane Diamond has been on the case from the get-go. Diane, response to that comment?
Well, you know, it's the same old song from Michael Jackson, and, you know, I try to see both sides of every story. I try to talk to as many people as I can, but I am kind of tired of feeling sorry for Michael Jackson and his bad childhood. According to Jermaine Jackson today on CNN, he didn't have a bad childhood. I mean, let's face it, he's a little weird. You know, he's just a little weird. Anybody
well, I
that
know
carves
that
up
Steve,
their face over and over again, you know.
I know that Steve Manning wants to respond to that. Steve?
What's that, Nancy? I'm sorry.
Well, Diane was pointing out several of the eccentricities of Michael Jackson over the past few years in response to that bite from him. Do you care to respond? And also, you were with him the entire day yesterday. How was he responding
you know,
to the news?
He was, Nancy, he was completely upbeat. He was jovial. He was like really in a great, I was shocked to see, he was in a good spirit. I was really surprised to see, happy to see he was in a good mood. And his family was there to support him. Jermaine was there, his parents, his other sisters and brothers. And he feels that he's innocent, and he is innocent, in my personal opinion. And he feels that every time a project comes out, there's a situation, there's a roadblock in his career.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let me go to you,
you know,
Jan
Nancy,
Carl.
I wonder,
go
Nancy,
ahead, Diane.
Could I just ask Steve a quick question?
Yes, Diane, how are you?
Because I hear these heartfelt, how are you, Steve? I'm interested to hear your viewpoints. Mm-hmm. And I wonder about the people close to Michael who talk about how wonderful he is and whatnot. Do they ever sit him down and say, hey,
This sleeping with kids in your bed has got to stop. You need like an intervention here, buddy, because it's looking kind of weird.
Well, Diane, if you remember Michael's interview last year with the guy from London, he said that he has slept with, a lot of times the kids sleep on the floor, I was told before. I've been to many times where his own niece and nephews have been at the ranch and at other places and hotels when he's on the road. And kids sleep on the floor. I mean, he is a little bit, he loves children.
He said they slept in his bed with him, though.
Yes, I understand that, but I would honestly say that nothing sexually or any kind of inappropriate behavior happened. I can tell you that. I would say for knowing
but
him.
But how are
that.
You so sure? How are you
because
so
I've
sure
known,
about that, Steve?
Because I've known him for over
30... Child molesters are our next-door neighbors. You know, they're everywhere. They're the priest in the parish, and they're the butcher
Diane,
down the block.
But, Diane, I've known Michael for 30 years, as well as other members of the family. He really loves children. I couldn't imagine doing something like that that would be inappropriate.
Okay, guys, hold on one moment. I want to go to Jan Carl on this. Mm-hmm. Jan has been covering the case for some time. You're with Entertainment Tonight. What's the difference in this round of allegations as opposed to 10 years ago?
Right. Obviously, there's all the legal differences, you know, that the DA has been talking about. But we were talking about this at Entertainment Tonight, that one of the biggest differences we're seeing is 10 years ago, there was a huge bank of celebrities that came forward, went on the record, and defended him. Elizabeth Taylor, of course, has known him for years and years as well. Before she came forward, I think her quote was something along the lines of that she believed in, quote, Michael's integrity, his love and trust in children. Now, I have to credit MSNBC. They tried to reach her today and, quote, unquote, Miss Taylor will have no comment, is what her spokeswoman said. Elizabeth Taylor, that was her. Also, Liza Minnelli, they contacted her. She has no comment. One of the biggest differences I'm seeing is that, you know, the people that supported him in the past, who said they trusted and believed in him, you know, they're stepping back.
Why do you think there's a difference?
You know, you have to wonder if it's that where there's smoke, is there fire? You know, I think they're hesitating. Maybe they're going to wait and see how this plays out, finally, in a court of law.
Right. And you know, another thing, Jim Hammer, it could be just the promulgation, the accumulation of charges. First, there was the battle 10 years ago. Now there's this time. Is it a snowball effect?
Well, I want to pick up on what was just said about smoke. Where there's smoke, there's fire. Maybe he didn't do it. None of us know tonight he did it for sure. But I hope to God there is a trial this time. Because if it's true that he molested this boy and molested other boys, this system colossally failed 10 years ago. When a rich, powerful man bought off a kid and his family to stop a criminal trial. That's one of the changes
minute,
in the
Jim,
law is that you can't.
Before you blame the prosecutor, and believe me, tonight I'm right down the middle of the road.
I'm blame the prosecutor.
I'm not taking the side of the prosecutor tonight, but I do have a question. Isn't it true that after the last round of allegations 10 years ago, the law was changed?
In
because
a couple of
then
ways.
The prosecutor couldn't make the
powerless.
Child testify.
Well, the big change is that now a prosecutor can actually stop the civil proceeding from going forward. It can say, put that on hold until we finish the criminal trial. Secondly, there was a new exception to the hearsay rule in California. So if a kid wouldn't testify and was under 12 years old, a doctor or psychotherapist could come in and say, here's what Johnny said happened.
But he didn't have that tool 10 years
correct.
Ago.
I'm not blaming
so if the victim didn't testify 10 years ago, he was basically up the creek without a paddle.
I'm blaming the system that allowed it to happen.
I see.
The point. Here's the big difference this time. If this goes to trial, not just this boy will testify, but every other prior alleged victim who has the courage to come forward will come forward. California law allows that, and the jury will hear the whole story and make a decision.
Before we go to break, Chris Pixley, I'm sure you have seen the lyrics that Michael Jackson wrote about the district attorney. He's a cold man. He's a cold man. He says it like 50 times. He accuses him of being a racist. Do you think there's any truth to the fact, to the allegations that have been made today, that this is a get back on the part of the DA's office?
Well, I don't know if there's any truth to it, but the interesting thing that's going to come out here is that we have Mark Garagos handling two high-profile cases right now.
Exactly. Right,
and the crossover of these cases puts him in a very difficult position. If he's arguing police misconduct in the Peterson case...
Making all that money? What's the difficult position?
This is his job, Nancy, but aside from the money that he gets paid, if he's forced to make the argument in the Peterson case, or if he elects to make the argument that there's police misconduct there, he turns around and starts saying that, well, the DA here has a vendetta against Michael Jackson. With the media covering this event the way they are, he's going to start to lose credibility. So he's pinned in as well. Mm-hmm. You don't know if there's any truth to the DA having it out for this man, Michael Jackson, but it's going to be a very hard pill to swallow if it's coming out of Mark Garagos's mouth, and it's not going to be coming from anywhere else right now.
I have a question. When we see, for instance, in a rape case, we see the defense obviously attacking the credibility of the woman. What will happen in a case where it's a 12-year-old child?
Oh,
I already heard them talking about the credibility of this family. So are they going to attack?
Diane, before we go to break, Jan brought up a great theory here. We've seen Garagos go for the jugular with Amber Fry in the Scott Peterson case. Whole different ball game when you've got a 12-year-old little boy as the alleged victim. No way can he have that gloves off cross-exam.
And especially a 12-year-old cancer patient. Yeah, I hope everybody is getting this undercurrent here, Nancy. The district attorney and the sheriff here in Santa Barbara are saying that Michael Jackson not only molested a child, but he molested a sick and perhaps dying child. Keep that in mind. Garagos cannot attack this kid on the stand.
Well, so says Diane Diamond. It's all playing out in California right now. We're going to find out about the whereabouts of Michael Jackson, we think, in Nevada. Stay with us.
The booking process took approximately 30 to 45 minutes, was completed without incident. Mr. Jackson's people were very cooperative throughout this process. And the Sheriff's Department would like to forward their appreciation for that cooperation at this point in time.
Even without the changes in the law, the Santa Barbara District Attorney says this case is different.
There is no anticipation that there will be a civil case filed in this particular case. And the last reason that this is different in this particular case, we have a cooperative victim.
Jackson says he's an innocent man who just loves children. Now, these new accusations paint a far more sinister picture of Jackson, and this time it may be up to a jury to decide his guilt or innocence. George Lewis, NBC News, Los Angeles.
You know, the question a lot of you have asked is, why didn't the people closest to him do more to prevent at least the appearance of this type of problem? Joining me now, some people who may help us with the answer, from New York radio talk show host and Jackson family friend, Flo Anthony. From Chicago, private investigator Ernie Rizzo. Rizzo was hired by the father of the child who first accused Michael Jackson back in 1993. Mm-hmm. And from Burbank, clinical psychologist Robert Butterworth. All right, Flo, why didn't the friends do more and say, you know what, Michael, it's time to stop having sleepovers?
I don't think that Michael is the type of person that you can just tell what to do. Even though he's extremely childlike, he's his own man. And as he's consistently said, he's felt that there was nothing sexual going on. There was nothing wrong with any of this. And he's kind of lived his own life. I think that we saw a lot with Michael Jackson tonight. He walked into that courthouse in handcuffs. He walked out still blowing kisses and acknowledging his fans and the people around him.
Speaking of that issue, this is Michael Jackson back in 1993. This is number three here, talking about how he helps children.
Dan, you know, when you look
throughout
at Michael...
Throughout my life, I have only tried to help thousands upon thousands of children to live happy lives. It brings tears to my eyes when I see any child who suffers. I am not guilty of these allegations, but if I am guilty of anything, it is of giving all that I have to give to help children all over the world.
Bob Butterworth, you want to make a comment?
Well, yeah, Dan, he's either guilty or he's probably the most naive man in America. We also know that Michael Jackson, an American tragedy. I mean, here's a youngster who didn't have a childhood. He spent most of his time locked in his house, either performing or rehearsing. But the problem is, these people are, that are coming out today, like Jermaine, calling this a lynching. Why weren't these people at Neverland Ranch shaking this guy, saying, wait a minute, ditch the Captain Crunch clothes, start getting rid of these, disassembling the little, the giraffe cage and the roller coaster. Get away from kids. You already lost allegedly $20 million 10 years ago. You're being set up. So he's either guilty or he's naive, but somebody needs to come in and set this guy.
Cooperated with us, and they're aware of the risks involved, and they still cooperate with us.
Welcome back to Larry King Live. I'm Nancy Grace from CourtTV, and for Larry tonight, and I want to thank you for being with us as we bring you the very latest in the investigation as to Michael Jackson. Let me go to you, Chris Pixley. We're talking about how Garagos could possibly cross-examine a young boy.
not just a young boy, but a young cancer victim. What about the angle of attacking the boy's family on the money issue? That way he's not really attacking the boy, but he's getting a lot of points on cross-exam.
Yeah, that's absolutely what I think will occur here. Obviously, there's the possibility that the boy doesn't understand what he's saying, that the boy has somehow dreamt this up. But the reality is, I think Mark Garagos is first going to focus in this particular situation on this family. And they're going to be, ultimately, they will be dragged through the mud the same way Michael Jackson is being dragged through the mud. The focus will be on their every word and deed and on their motivations. And there's reason to ask those questions because this is a family, this is not a typical situation. This is a family that has allowed their child to have alone time with Michael Jackson, a man who is known, at least is rumored, to have a strange relationship
with children. That's right, rumored, not known.
So
I'll take Larry's role tonight. He's just charged. He hasn't been convicted.
Where is Judge King?
Yeah. Yeah, Nancy, I even have people saying, could the parents, you know, be held responsible for allowing their child to be with Michael? Now, I don't think, you know, I'm not a lawyer.
Steve Manning. I've heard that bandied about as well. Steve Manning, everyone, is a dear friend of the Jackson family. Speaking of the money motive that a lot of people are alleging the day after, do you think it's all about money, Steve?
You know, Nancy, it's always about money. Let me say something. I would like to say that Michael, last year during that Martin Bashir special, the cancer victim, cancer is a horrible, dreadful disease, as we know. The boy admitted that he was healed from going to the ranch. Michael opened his home to his parents, to the boy. He traveled to the parents. I mean, the boy was healed. Thank God for that. And let me say something about children against Michael. Michael's own nieces and nephews from a very large family, the kids have been embarrassed to go to school. The media has turned this into a frenzy. The kids are afraid to go to school. The kids have been teased, just like allegedly this boy was teased. It's been horrible on the Jackson grandkids.
We are taking your calls, everyone. Steve Manning is with us, a Jackson family friend. You know, of course, his statement is going to be looked at in detail, and the more detail a young victim can provide makes his story more believable. Do you think it's all about money?
Well, listen, this is really outrageous, I have to say. You know, everyone's going to great pains to talk about Michael Jackson's presumption of innocence, but to already attack this young boy who's in hiding somewhere, some 12-year-old kid, and accuse him of making this up because of money, I think is outrageous, and everyone ought to just stop it right now.
You know, very rarely do you see the attack on alleged victims this early in the game. Well, we haven't even been in this 48 hours.
This poor child is going to face the biggest PR machine in the world.
You know what, Nancy, again, the boy has cancer. He's healed now, thank God. But listen, the parents, whoever's behind this whole thing, this is like a war going on. And when some of that war...
Hold on one second.
War, use every weapon you have to get to the line and get the war over with.
And that's what Michael's people are doing.
Everybody, quick break. It's heating up here on the set. We are taking your calls. We're going straight to your calls when we get back from this break. Stay with us.
Look, I'm going to just make a brief statement. I'm not going to take questions and answers. Michael is here. He's come back specifically to confront these charges head on. He is greatly outraged by the bringing of these charges. He considers this to be a big lie. He understands the people who are outraged, because if these charges were true, I assure you Michael would be the first to be outraged. But I'm here to tell you today, and Michael has given me the authority to say on his behalf, these charges are categorically untrue. He looks forward to getting into a courtroom as opposed to any other forum and confronting these accusations head on. We plan on doing that, and I'm not going to take any other questions and answers. I will say, however, that he has already, for your information at least, he's already posted the bond and he's processed out. Thank you very much.
CourtTV is reporting that a 12-year-old boy has accused Michael Jackson of sexual abuse, but Michael has an alibi. He said at the time in question he was with a 13-year-old boy, so he should be okay. Police said today they are searching Michael's house looking for anything unusual, you know, like a girl.
You're a business migrating to IP telephony. You might think you've
done to try to ruin his new CD that was coming out or whatever it is he's doing. Like, the sheriff and I really are into that kind of music. But
Last question.
What do you say to parents who let their children go to Neverland Ranch on sleepovers? What is your
my advice is don't do it.
There you're seeing a press conference from the local district attorney, the man that is handling the case against Michael Jackson. Diane Diamond, I hear laughter in the press conference. I hear levity. If he hasn't heard Michael Jackson's lyrics in the past, he must have been living in a cave. I'm not saying the allegations are true or untrue, but what do you make of the lyrics of the song Michael Jackson wrote in response to the last investigation?
Well, I asked Tom Sneddon about that. You missed one crucial thing about those lyrics, Nancy.
Okay.
Over and over, it's a repeated Dom Sheldon, like Tom Sneddon, is a cold man, cold man, cold man. And it ends with a gunshot. Now, when I was first covering the Michael Jackson story...
You know what, Diane? You're absolutely right. I never heard the gunshot at the end.
Yeah.
You know what? Hold
it's
on.
It's clearly audible.
Instead of us talking about it, let's take a listen. Hold on. What about it, Jan?
Well, I was going to say, the only thing that in the lyrics that are actually printed, of course, it doesn't say Tom Sneddon, it says Dom Sheldon.
Mm-hmm.
So, you listen to it, Sheldon, you listen to it, and it sounds like he's saying Tom Sneddon. And disturbing, it's rather ominous at the end when the gunshot goes off.
Let's go to Robbie Ludwig, psychotherapist, joining us from New York. Robbie, what do you make of the lyrics?
Well, it's not uncommon for artists to express themselves through their music. They very often express their thoughts, their ideas, make political comments, and clearly Michael Jackson is expressing hostility and rage, and this may not be a bad way to express hostility and rage. I don't expect that Michael Jackson would be in danger of harming anyone in this kind of violent way, but he's expressing a strong emotion of how he is feeling victimized by the police department, and we know that this is a common theme with Michael Jackson. Very often he feels victimized by people.
You know, Robbie, a lot has been made of the alleged money motive for these allegations, but the law has been changed in California, and this young accuser, this alleged victim, can be brought into the courtroom and cross-examined. If he's not telling the truth, do you think it would come out that he had been manipulated by his family, his parents, someone with money motive?
You know, it is so hard to know. Very often children don't even want to report sexual abuse when it is going on, and that it doesn't come out until the sexual abuse has been going on for a very long time. And that's why sometimes children actually take back their initial statement, because there's a feeling of warmth and connection sometimes to the perpetrator, especially with pedophiles. It's not like the typical rapist that will go after a child and harm a child. These pedophiles, and I'm not saying that Michael Jackson is one, but they're very seductive and very charming, and they very often develop a relationship.
Nancy, may I join in now again, please?
To follow up on what you were saying, I think one of the most convincing things potentially about the case is going to be if this complaint came up in the context of talking to his therapist as opposed to going to a lawyer to try to get money, and it was the therapist who turned it on, then how can you say that was for a money motive?
Steve Manning?
Well, first of all, kids are manipulated. You know what? Let me say something. Law enforcement people were laughing. These are very serious charges. That's not talked about. And also, you know, there's a certain actor in Hollywood who went to a precinct in a certain film and shot up a whole precinct, and it mentioned one gunshot. That's not talked about.
We are taking your calls, everyone. Joining us tonight, Steve Manning, a Jackson family friend. Let's go to Memphis, Tennessee. Memphis.
Hi, Nancy Grace.
Hi.
You know, it appears based on the last couple of albums that Michael has put out that his career is over. Do you think, if proven innocent, that he can launch a comeback after all of these allegations?
Good question, Jan. What do you make?
You know, he's sort of been on the Dadwood trend actually since before the 1993 allegations.
The man's still a multimillionaire.
He's still a multimillionaire.
And exactly the downward trend for the rest of us.
Compared to what? Yeah, no, not at all. And for most artists, for instance, his last album sold 2 million. That's considered very good compared to what Michael used to do. It is not. I think it all started. It was when there were the rumors about the wanting to buy the Elephant Man's skeletal remains. All those things came up.
Oh, as no, more he's and not more, eccentric. You know,
the, that. The dangling baby, as all those things came about, I do think fans, they were backing away. At the same time, I will say, any artist who's had a career that has spanned 3 decades, such as Michael has, you look at that and say, you know, anyone who can still sell 2 million albums, that's still pretty good compared to his
current
base. No. Go ahead,
Nancy.
Steve.
Nancy, you know, a certain journalist would leave Michael alone and not base their career on attacking him, he would be fine. He will come back. You know, this man has sold over 100 million CDs and is always saying in the press, the so-called proclaimed king of pop. He's the king of pop just based on his record sales.
Everybody, we are taking a quick break. I see your calls are lined up. We're taking them on Larry King Live. I'm in for Larry tonight, not as a former prosecutor, but trying to fill his chair impartially. So help me with your phone calls. Stay with us.
This thing with Michael Jackson is just, it's a case that came in. The sheriff and I have committed that we're going to handle it like any other case to the extent that we can.
The focal point of these investigations, this investigation and the one in 93. You know, Jerry made a very interesting point. He pointed out that this last record sold about 2 million units. Well, that's domestic sales. The fact of the matter is, to even underscore his point more, the other 5 or 6 million units that were sold did come from foreign sales.
Yeah.
So there's no denying the fact there's a real following out there. But the thing about that record underscores Michael Jackson's spending run amok. He spent $25 to $30 million to produce that record. That's an unheard of amount.
Yeah.
8 million copies won't do it when you spend that much.
Brett Pulley, thanks for coming in. Jerry Nachman, good to see you. We'll be talking.
Sony spent $25 million promoting it.
That's right. That doesn't include the promotion costs.
Got to wrap it up, Jerry. We'll be checking back in with you from Santa Barbara, I am certain. Thanks a lot. Coming up, will Jackson's arrest become the biggest legal case of the new decade, overshadowing all others for years to come? I say no. It's my closing argument. Plus, your emails coming up.
What's coming up on the news?
Coming up on the news at the top of the hour, we'll have more on the... Told his dad that he wanted to have 10 children. He wanted to match his dad's number, which that's what his dad had.
We were talking about his relationship with Lisa Marie Presley, and you know something about it. Well, explain that.
Well, you know, what Lisa Marie has said is that she said that she really kind of signed on to this idea that he was this innocent and that they were going to kind of save the world together. And I think, you know, since they got divorced about 2 years later, that she quickly kind of realized that that wasn't the case. And I think she quickly kind of realized for her own image that this was not a guy that she wanted to hang on to. I mean, when I interviewed him, I asked him about the plastic surgery, and he said, well, it's just my nose, it's nothing else. And Lisa Marie, in fact, told me that Elvis had his nose done.
Yeah,
and laterward, afterward, she read that interview, and this was for TV Guide, and she took the TV Guide and threw it across the room. And she was so furious that he was saying, you know, that Elvis had his nose done.
Then, of course, there's this Debbie Rowe he married, but she's not allowed to see his kids.
Well, yes, that is.
They have no relationship.
There are really no stranger arrangements there. When you're birthing two babies for Michael Jackson, and you can't have any contact with them, and she does nothing but
so that relationship was all about finding a mother, basically, is what he wanted.
Right, and she's obviously set for life, I would have to imagine.
I would guess. She's not speaking. Nobody's speaking to her.
Right, she hasn't spoken recently, and she's only, in the few times she's been interviewed, she's spoken very highly
of him. That's who we want to get, don't we, Lisa? Let me ask you about it. He had a deal with his record company when they had to refer to him as the king of pop. This came from him, right?
Well, this is the thing. Everybody's right. And the media has always, for some years now, referred to him as the king of pop. I remember, you know, being a celebrity journalist and getting the facts from Michael and his people that said, you must now refer to Michael Jackson as the king
of
pop.
And you were denied access if you didn't get...
Right. It was like, kind of, you know, at the time, we kind of bought into it. It was a little bit lazy because you hear a tagline. It's like, okay, helping you do your work for you.
Right,
something else to call him. And yes, but it's like, who Who does that? And it also sort of seemed like it was one of the lesser, not
Please
quite
call me
bizarre,
the king of liberals from now on.
Right. I mean, he had done so many. he had done so many other bizarre things that at the time it didn't seem that bizarre. But right, yes, that came from Michael.
All right. We'll continue with the king of liberals, Alan Combs, on the other side of the break. You're watching the Network America Trust for Real Journalism. We're fair. We're balanced. Thank you.
And if he did, what was his intent? Not intended to minimize that, but who can really identify with Michael Jackson? He seems so foreign, it's almost impossible to relate to him. And unlike these other cases, it's not that hard to believe he could have done it. Doesn't mean he did. Just means that the fascination factor may be surprisingly low. And since the alleged victim is a child, that boy will be shielded from the public. Despite the fact that Jackson's one of the best-known people in the world, I just don't know that the world will care all that much what happens, about the outcome. It'll be big. But for all of you high-minded journalistic purists predicting the demise of the news business in the months to come, rest assured, I don't think it'll be the defining moment some of you fear. Coming up, what should happen to Michael Jackson's kids? Some of you have some ideas. Your emails up next.
Why do they have to have a press conference?
And then they tell us that they don't have charges ready to file against him. And they're reaching out to the community and saying, please, if there's somebody else out there, please come forward. That all suggests that maybe they have a child statement, but nothing else.
Let's go to Bullhead City, Arizona. Bullhead, are you with me?
Yes, Nancy. Hi.
Hi.
My question for the panel is 93 allegations. Mm-hmm. Everything in between, suspicious to people's minds, and he's still allowed. I'm in support of Michael. I think he's had to go through a lot. Why is he allowed to, you know, have his three children, which I believe he takes care of, but it was never in the question of anybody's mind while he was obtaining his three children?
Good point. Let's go to Diane. Diane, I've only got a few seconds left. Can you respond?
I think it was on a lot of people's minds as he got each one of those children. Children Public Service, the people here, the social workers here, are not yet involved as far as I know, but then we wouldn't know because it's always kept secret. I think it may be one reason why Michael Jackson went back to Vegas after the booking today. I don't think he wants to bring those kids back here to California just yet. Mm-hmm. I don't blame him.
We are taking a quick break, everyone. More on the Michael Jackson investigation when we come back. Stay with us. The estimates from people I'm hearing is that it'll do between 80 and 100,000 in its first week. Now, by
That's
comparison,
pretty good, though.
It's pretty good. By comparison, Britney will probably do between 5 and 600,000. The Beatles will probably do 300,000. But it's the greatest hits. It's every song that you've ever heard, with the exception of one new single. So it's actually doing okay.
I like when someone asks the DA, isn't it a coincidence that you're doing this on the day his album comes out? He says, well, I'm not exactly into that kind of music.
Right.
It's not exactly what he's into.
Yeah, I believe him.
So we expect, people are perversely going to buy this simply to see, what's this weirdo up to? I want to get his album.
They might, but you know what? A lot of songs on there you can get in, you can get on other albums, unless you want to say, I bought this on the day the allegations broke. Right. Write that in your diary,
Lisa, we were talking in a break. You think, in some really perverted way, having met him, followed his career, watched this guy, that you think he probably, in spite of how heinous these charges are, that he would like this, the coverage of it?
I actually think, I don't know that I necessarily think that he's consciously thinking that, but I think somewhere deep down in him, yes, I think that's true, because I think that it reinforces in him how important he is to the society. I think that the worst thing for Michael Jackson is to be forgotten and ignored. He is all about his legacy. He is all about how the artists who've come after him have imitated him, his dance moves, his singing style. I mean, he makes a point in an interview to constantly tell you about how much he's loved, about how many fans he has worldwide. I mean, he said that, when he wrote the song for 9/11, that George Bush Sr. called him an international hero. I mean, he's anything.
He talks. He's a real narcissist. He's.
He's a sweet
an ego.
I believe that he's a sweet and a generous man, and he'll be very pleasant to you in person. But he really wants to let you know how important and vital he is, and so that's why I think, as you said,
I think we'd survive without him. I mean, in as much as not, we would survive. survive without his music. We'd survive without
his
egomania.
The flip side is, for a lot of people, he defined a generation. I mean, Thriller is something that is so unbelievable, that fame. That album did better selling the second Christmas than the first Christmas, which never happens in record sales.
Who cares?
He reached a plateau that just broke through.
That's a plateau.
Appreciate you being with us tonight. Thank you very much. That is all the time we have left for tonight. Stay tuned. On the Record, Greta Van Susteren is coming up next. We'll see you tomorrow night, 9 Eastern, here, Hannity and Combs on Fox News. Thank you for watching us. Have a great night.
Been arrested and booked. Where is he tonight? Fox News' Trace Gallagher is at Jackson's Neverland Ranch with all the latest. Trace?
And Greta, the conventional wisdom was that Michael Jackson would come right back here to his Neverland Ranch. It's only about a 30-minute drive from the jail in Santa Barbara. Instead, he left the jail. He went directly back to the airport, got back on his jet, and yes, flew back to Las Vegas. He landed at McCarran Airport earlier tonight. When he got off his plane, his security detail tried to put up blankets to shelter him. The media still got their shots. The media continued following Michael Jackson. It was like a tour around Las Vegas. He went through Vegas. He went through Henderson. At one point in time, he stopped at an intersection, rolled down the windows, and waved to the media and some fans. He did not get the same reception here in Santa Barbara today. When he arrived, he was handcuffed. It was the shot seen round the world. It will be on every front page of every newspaper tomorrow morning. Michael Jackson in handcuffs going into the jail. The processing went fairly smoothly. It lasted 45 minutes. Michael Jackson was booked. He was fingerprinted, cited, and then Michael Jackson took the mugshot. Also very famous by now, getting tons of airplay. The mugshot on the website and spread throughout the media, saying that Michael Jackson is 5 feet 11 inches tall and weighs 120 pounds. Now, Michael Jackson did try to throw us a couple of curves throughout the day. When he left the jail, he left through a back door. Fox had the only cameras there trained on him. He walked out with Mark Garagos and gave the peace sign, got in the car, and went to the airport. Mark Garagos likely telling Michael Jackson what he tells his other clients: if you believe you're innocent, act like you're innocent, and do business as normal. Michael Jackson apparently back in Vegas finishing up that music video that he started 3 weeks ago. The Jackson camp releasing this statement tonight saying, quote, "Lies run sprints, but the truth runs marathons. The truth will win this marathon in court." Michael Jackson tonight, Greta, back in Las Vegas after a very public arrest in Santa Barbara. Greta.
Trace, thank you. The image will make headlines around the world. Michael Jackson being led into the Santa Barbara police station in handcuffs, where he's booked on child molestation charges. Where does Jackson go from here? We turn to our panel. In Los Angeles, our Santa Monica criminal defense attorney, Steve Krohn, who also represented comic Paula Poundstone, and creator and executive producer of celebrity justice attorney, Harvey Levin. The district attorney of Wichita, Kansas, Nola Folston, joins us on the phone from Tucson. In Washington, our criminal defense attorneys, Bernie Grimm and Ted Williams, an extra TV correspondent, Michael Bryant, joins us from the Neverland Ranch. Steve, all right, let's start with the mugshot. Is that standard operating procedure, putting mugshots in California on websites?
Well, I don't know about putting them on websites. It's standard to take a mugshot, and when you release it to the media is going to do whatever they want with it. So it's just a matter of time. We knew it was going to be out there, whether it's going to go on websites or newspapers. That's going to be the shot heard around the world, and we knew it was going to happen.
Steve, what happens to his children while this is pending? He still, everything stays the same?
Well, it's an interesting question. You can bet that the Department of Children and Family Services in Santa Barbara has been notified by the district attorney and the sheriffs that they should be looking at this. They probably knew about this 6 months ago when he gave that interview. I would imagine they're investigating right now. Their proceedings are confidential. They're not made known to us, but you can bet a lot of money that they're looking at this very carefully. They're going to be deciding whether or not to take some action to either take the kids away, put them into a separate home, monitor his visits or whatever, but they're clearly going to be looking at it.
Harvey, when they first had the press conference, the sheriff and the DA, they mentioned the search of Neverland, but they said two other places searched. Do you have any information? Do we know where the other places were?
Yeah, we do indeed. Celebrity Justice. In fact, I spoke with one of the people who whose house was searched today. He is the videographer of Michael Jackson, the former videographer. He told me today that 2 days ago, 15 officers came to his home in West Hills. They actually handcuffed him for the first half hour. They seized around seven videotapes that he had shot of this 12-year-old Los Angeles boy and Michael Jackson, and they had seized five computers as well. We also know, Greta, that the this videographer apparently has a videotape of the boy and his mother saying basically that nothing untoward ever happened between the boy and Michael Jackson. However, we also know that this video was shot before the alleged molestation occurred.
All right, Nola Folser joins us by phone. Nola, your thoughts tonight on what the prosecution is planning?
Well, first of all, on the mugshot issue, those are open records under just about any open records law. So the minute they're taken, they are free game as far as the media or the public is concerned. As far as this case is concerned, the prosecution is going to follow the ethical rules and responsibility that they have. And Mr. Sneddon's office is going to shut down any discussion about this case. They've given the basic information to the media in a news release, and that's about all you're going to hear from them. I've spoken with Mr. Sneddon. We are acquainted with each other from the National District Attorneys Association. In fact, that's what I'm doing in Tucson, and have visited with him about the status of the case, and will report that there's a lot of rumors that are going to be circulated. Most of them are factually incorrect. Those will be shown as the time goes on in this case, but the case is was actually ready to be processed a long time before, but they lacked the law enforcement resources to be able to get the job done until just recently, which I think flies in the face of some statements that this was getting ready to be done just at the time he was going to be releasing a video.
Right.
So that's
right,
some of the issues.
Great. Thank you, Noel. Let's go to Neverland, where Michael Bryant is standing by. Michael, what's going on at Neverland tonight?
Well, it's getting less crowded here, Greta. A lot of folks are starting to pull out. They've had enough of the, as you can see, a little chillier weather up here. And let's face it, since Michael didn't return home, there's not a lot of reason to stay around anymore. So it's definitely more calm than last time we talked.
All right, Ted, search of the house. You suspect something, don't you?
I suspect that when they went into Neverland that they may very well have left some bugs there. I don't know that, but that could be in these kind of cases, standard operating procedures in some instances. So if they left some bugs there, quite naturally, I think Garrigus is smart enough to know, hey, Mike, you don't want to go back there and make any representations.
All right, Bernie, quickly, what would you advise Michael Jackson tonight if you were his lawyer?
You know, one, obviously, completely contrary to Scott Peterson, keep your mouth shut. No interviews with Diane Sawyer, no interviews with Barbara Walters, just weather this storm as best you can. Now, it is hard for a public figure to do something like that.
But he's maintained a pretty cloistered life anyway, in spite of his notoriety, especially recently. All right, panel, stand by. We got much more. And up next, where did Michael Jackson spend last night? And who showed up in his room early this morning? A live report from Vegas is next. And later, the woman who threw Michael Jackson's 45th birthday party is here to go on the record. Plus, his former brother-in-law is here.
Mr. Jackson has been booked into the county jail. He has since been released. He has posted the bail, and he has been given an arraignment date of January 9th.
Did he talk to you about it? Did he deny the charges to you? Did he say I didn't do it?
Absolutely. And I'm not going to discuss any further after that. Yes. No comment after that. Yes, he did.
Okay. Well, also here tonight, we've got O.J. Simpson's attorney, Yael Galander. Yael, you've talked to O.J. Simpson today. What's his take on this Michael Jackson trial?
Well, he thinks, you know, that the whole thing's a sham. He thinks that Michael's being set up. He thinks it's a shakedown for money. Anytime somebody goes to a civil lawyer, gets advised, goes to a therapist, and then goes to a prosecutor, it's got shakedown written all
Yael,
over it.
Yael, are you saying that's what's happened? Yael, do you have information that the family of this 12-year-old boy first went to a civil trial attorney and then went to a psychiatrist and then went to the police?
If you believe the reports that have been coming out all day about the family consulting with civil attorneys and the civil attorney that filed the lawsuit against Michael Jackson 10 years ago and the lawyer sending the child to the lawyer's therapist and then reporting it to the prosecutor,
break it down first. For people out there that are watching, you say civil attorney. What does that mean? That means somebody who's not a criminal attorney who actually will try to sue Michael Jackson in the end.
Listen,
the
big difference between criminal prosecutors and defense lawyers and civil lawyers is civil lawyers are only after one thing, and that's money, money, money. Criminal defense lawyers protect people's liberties, and criminal prosecutors try and take away that liberty.
Yeah, they do it all for free, I guess, Yael Galanter. And, you know, Joe, I got to ask you a question. Why on earth would anyone want to know O.J. Simpson's take on anything? O.J. Simpson was found legally responsible by a civil jury for the deaths of two human beings. O.J. Simpson's views on this case are, frankly, the last thing that I would want to hear. I was a civil attorney representing many child sexual abuse victims in California in the 1990s. And I can tell you, I was proud to represent those children. Going after a 12-year-old cancer survivor, calling him a liar, immediately going on the attack when he has not filed a civil suit, I think that's reprehensible.
Well, you know,
why does he have to file a civil suit, Lisa? The fact that he's even consulted with civil lawyers.
Oh, God
what
forbid.
What do civil lawyers
God
do?
God forbid they sue a 12-year-old child would consult with an attorney to find out what his legal rights are.
Oh, come on, Lisa. This 12-year-old child.
This is America. He has the right to talk to an attorney just like O.J. Simpson.
Let me bring Steve Manning back here. Hold on a second. Steve Manning, does Michael Jackson believe, and we're not saying this is the case, does Michael Jackson believe this is part of a financial shakedown to get money from him?
I'm not going to comment on that at this time.
Have you talked to anybody in Michael Jackson's camp who believes this is about a shakedown, a financial shakedown?
Well, I'll speak personally. It seems quite so. It certainly does. It's all about the money.
How can it be all about the money when this kid has not asked for a dime, has
the
not
parents,
filed a civil suit?
Lisa,
come on, it has nothing to do with the kid. It's the parents.
She hasn't filed a civil suit either.
They're directing the kid on what to do.
You got to say something about a 12-year-old kid, and why not make up a motivation he wants money?
Hold on, Lisa Bloom, though. One of the things that has made this 12-year-old and the family, let's say, more credible than others in the past is the fact that we've been told, at least initially, that they're not interested in making any money off of this. I've heard this 1,000 times on news, and what we've heard is all they're interested in doing is bringing Michael Jackson to justice, and that's great. But Yael tells us tonight that even before they went to a criminal attorney, they first went to a civil attorney
and
to see what
the right.
They have the right to consult with
an attorney, just like O.J. Simpson has the right to have Yael Galanter advising him. A 12-year-old who contends that he was molested by Michael Jackson should go to an attorney and get legal advice and find out what his rights are.
Absolutely.
Now, I represented kids in civil cases, and let me tell you, I always told them, go to the police first, let the criminal case run its course first, then we'll talk about filing civil charges later. But a kid has the right, you know, to get compensation for therapy, for any damages,
certainly
a compensation
do.
For pain and suffering,
and, Lisa,
and they should not
and
be
again,
ashamed
Lisa,
to ask
certainly,
for that.
Certainly, Lisa, nobody here is suggesting they aren't. It just, again, we've been told one story. I'm just very interested in what Yael's told us. Now, Yael, the question is, and Lisa asked this question earlier, why would anybody be interested in O.J. Simpson's take on it? I would guess that millions of people would be interested because O.J. Simpson was involved in what has been considered the trial of the century, at least last century. It looks like this new trial may be the new trial of the century. How do you believe, how does O.J. Simpson believe, how do other people who've been involved in that case think this case, the Michael Jackson trial, is going to stack up to that?
This case will be the biggest legal event on the planet. This will make the O.J. Simpson murder case look like a walk in the park.
Why?
There's going to be more media, instant coverage, more analysis, 24 hours a day. Whenever you turn on the television, either yesterday or today, all you saw was legal commentators, people on CourtTV, people on MSNBC, people on every network that cover these legal issues, discussing it from all during prime time. And at the height of the O.J. case, you didn't have that. And you're going to have
you know,
it here.
From,
Michael
you know,
Jack. Just one other thing, Joe.
Yes.
Michael Jackson is an absolute superstar. He's one of the most recognizable people on the planet. This is going to be the biggest media event to ever occur.
Steve Manning, respond.
Yes, Michael Jackson, without a doubt, is the biggest entertainer in the whole wide world. This will be, the trial will be another trial of the century. And I think the media should not try this in the court. The media should not try this. Let the court decide this.
I think we're going to have this discussion in the coming weeks about it and months. We got a lot more to come on Scarborough Country, and we want to hear what you think about Michael Jackson's arrest. Give us a call at 888-MSNBC-USA. And also, Michael Jackson settled out of court on similar allegations 10 years ago. And yet hundreds of children still visit Neverland every year. A lot of people are asking, why are parents letting their kids go there? Then, we're going to ask the Jacksons' former spiritual advisor and his personal magician how the king of pop treats his own children. Plus, we'll examine Michael Jackson's own history of bizarre behavior. That's coming up.
Oh man, I saw the interview that he did, and he said he's Peter Pan. Come on, that's ridiculous. Peter Pan, 40-year-old man, Peter Pan.
He called the allegations, quote, a big lie.
At least 27 people were killed. And
this Jackson friend told Los Angeles TV station KNBC that's what happened when he had an innocent sleepover in 1993.
Have you slept in the same bed with him?
Yeah, but I was on one side, he was on the other. It's a this big bed.
Child psychiatrists say there's no reason for any grown adult to sleep with children.
What's the reason behind it? That just doesn't strike me as being a reasonable, sane, safe thing to do in general.
Yet, even after today's charges Gaynor Morgan thinks are lies, she wants her 10-year-old son Alex to keep their appointment at Neverland next summer.
I'd be fine for him to stay and spend time and, you know, confident.
And in Dallas, Sally Thomas backs Michael. Her 5-year-old son Travis visited Jackson on a Make-A-Wish grant 8 years ago.
I don't think he sees himself as a 45-year-old man when he's with these children because he's out there playing just like they are.
Leaving some to complain, Michael Jackson may be Peter Pan, but it's the parents who are in Neverland. Jim Avila, NBC News, Miami.
For more tonight and some advice perhaps on what to tell your children about the Jackson case, we're joined by Robert Butterworth, a clinical psychologist. He's joining us from Los Angeles. Good to see you.
Hi, Liz.
I can't tell you how many people I've heard today say that this child's parents should be in jail themselves for ever having allowed the boy to go near Neverland Ranch. Is that a common feeling that you're seeing, and is it a fair emotion?
And up next, meet a woman who has visited Michael Jackson's ranch at least 10 times with her children and grandchildren. She'll take us inside Neverland. But first, Michael Jackson's attorney Mark Garagus and his former brother-in-law go on the record.
Convicted of anything, but again, parents put their kids in this type of situation knowing that there had been these other darker accusations.
And, you know, today it's interesting because we're watching all of this and we're hearing, you know, all the friends of Michael coming out of the woodwork saying, we support you, Michael. Where were these people months ago when Michael was surrounded by children? Regardless of whether he's guilty or innocent, we know one thing. Somebody should have told Michael, Michael, don't put yourself in this situation because
exactly.
People may try to entrap you. Where were these people that are saying, Michael, you're being lynched? Where were his friends when he really needed them?
Dr. Butterworth, what were you doing at Neverland Ranch at that party? Are you friends with Michael Jackson?
Well, I was actually downtown Los Angeles. They had a very public birthday party for Michael with about 300 people. And basically, I went to pretty much look at the people as opposed to spend time with Michael. I was trying to understand the phenomena of how people could be mesmerized by somebody who I, in a psychological sense, feel tragic about. I mean, here's Michael Jackson, an American tragedy. Here's a person that we know from the biography that was, in a sense, imprisoned at home, pretty much forced all the time to either rehearse or perform, and he didn't have a childhood. This poor man is somewhat stuck in some phase, and as a result, there are tragedies all around, both in his life and for apparently people that he touches.
What do parents tell their children who might really look up to Michael Jackson?
You know, this is really difficult. I mean, we've been sitting here for months talking to kids about bad things ever since 9/11 and then the Elizabeth Smart kidnapping. I think what we have to do is we have to sit down and we have to say, you know, sometimes people say that some people touch children in places they shouldn't touch. And we don't know if it's true or not, but you use that as a way to teach your children that if anyone ever touches you in a place that you feel uncomfortable, please tell mommy and don't hide it.
Exactly.
I mean, that's all we can do. This is very, very difficult for parents.
Clinical psychologist Robert Butterworth, we thank you very much for joining us tonight.
Thank you, Liz.
And another music legend is finding himself...
It's immoral, it's disgusting, but in a country and in a culture where celebrity is the be-all and end-all, where we talk day and night about the size of J-Lo's butt getting bigger and smaller and whether she and Ben Affleck are going to marry, I don't understand why we're so surprised that people can OD on celebrity, and that's exactly what happened here.
Rabbi, let's look at Jackson's return to Las Vegas this evening. His SUV drove slowly through the streets, and he was being mobbed. He's been he was shaking hands through windows, had people stopping again. They did this for about two and a half hours, and it was like a hero's return from war. It's fair to ask the question, what's with these people?
These people have destroyed Michael Jackson, because had they treated him like an ordinary soul, he would not have thought that he could be arbitrary in deciding what is right and wrong. A man is not God, and the pressure to act like God is what leads to such incredibly odd behavior, because you can't be ordinary. Now, the same thing is true with these crazy fans. And, you know, with all due respect, I used to have contempt for them, because their life, Michael's life was their life. They were more interested in his comings and goings than in their own spouses or their own children. When we went to give the lecture at Oxford University together, he had about 2,000 European youth who camped outside his hotel in sleeping bags. And I walked out to them and I said, love his music, love his dancing, but he's a human being. And this is not good for you and it is not good for him.
Steve,
you see, one of the reasons I think there is unfortunate contempt for Michael is that there's never openness. These people guard him and they never give an inch. Michael should have said after that horrible admission on TV that he sleeps with children, mea culpa, I made a mistake, I regret it, I will never do it again. Instead, his crazy, adoring fans who show him complete and infinite adulation make that somewhat impossible because they make him feel like never give an inch. Even the combative rhetoric that we're hearing from Michael's camp now,
yeah.
I'm going to fight this, like, Michael should sound humble because even if he did this, and I hope he did not, he's got to come across that he gets it. Okay, I'm not a criminal. I didn't do this, but I know I get it. I should not be with children.
Let me bring in Steve Manning. Steve, the rabbi, obviously, who's Michael Jackson's former spiritual advisor. You see all the people around Michael Jackson. You see the adoring fans. You're in charge of the Jackson 5 fan club. Is it the fans' fault that Michael Jackson has taken this bizarre turn?
Well, you know, when you become the biggest artist in the world, which he indeed is, nobody can argue about that, these are the things that happens after you become so large. And I think that Michael is a very, very smart man. He knows what he's doing. And why be humble when you're innocent or you feel you're innocent? Why?
You know, Mr. Manning, can I interject for a second, Mr. Manning? I couldn't disagree with you more. With all due respect, you know and I know that Sony Records in the early 90s made music videos portraying Michael literally as a giant idol. Like an ancient totem. Hold on. And then Sony took. Then Sony took idols. An artist is not God. And then Sony took those idols and they literally put them on the Thames River in London and they put them in Prague. And I sat with Michael at Neverland watching these disturbing videos and I said, Michael, you come from such a religious background. How could you allow self-deification? This is what leads him to think he can make up his own rules.
Let me bring in Jerry Nagman right here. Jerry Nagman, you have covered so many trials. So many stories about celebrities. What's your take on how these people are mobbing Michael Jackson's automobile in Las Vegas right after he's been charged with molesting a 12-year-old child?
Joe, I can't figure out why people get up in the dark and stand out in the cold to wave a cardboard sign in front of Katie and Matt on the Today Show. This is just one of the things about our society. Let me tell you what's going on here in Southern California. Talk radio, as you can imagine, is just riven with this story. And the theme seems to be that Michael Jackson is a pedophile who has had all the trappings of a pedophile all these years. That Neverland is one big quicksand pit in which to entrap young kids, especially young boys. Hang on, let me finish this point.
Yes, go ahead.
I know you've been there, and let me tell you the descriptions, the video descriptions I've heard today, that on every landing in the staircase in his home, there are pictures of young boys, that his bedroom is surrounded, festooned with pictures of 10-year-old boys. Now, Rabbi,
that is preposterous. That is not true.
If you were
that
there,
is not true.
If you were there, did you not sense that that was an abomination?
Can I just say, I was in Michael's bedroom.
We got to have one at a time.
Rabbi, did you have enough of Michael, or did he have enough of you?
First of all, let me just say that Jerry Nachman is one of the smartest people in American media. It's an honor to be on with you. But, Jerry, I have to disagree with you about Neverland Valley being a cesspit.
Absolutely.
Let me just tell you why. See, yes, this is the problem. We're demonizing everything. It's like someone coming and saying that the whole Catholic Church, that every single Catholic ritual is about getting little boys into a priesthood.
Rabbi, we're going to have to leave it there. We're going to come right back, though. And just ahead on Scarborough Country, we're going to be taking your phone calls. Plus, the many faces of Michael Jackson. This guy is not normal. If he weren't a millionaire or a rock star, would he be institutionalized? We're going to talk to his friends about the freak show that seems to surround Michael Jackson. But first, let's get the latest headlines.
Hello, everyone. I'm Alex Witt at 26 past the hour. Here are those headlines. As Joe Scarborough has been talking about, Michael Jackson is now at the Green Valley Ranch Resort in Henderson, Nevada, this near Las Vegas. He is free on $3 million bail after surrendering to authorities in Santa Barbara, California, this afternoon on those child molestation charges. Now, during his booking, a mugshot was taken that you'll see here, and Jackson is scheduled to be arraigned on January 9th. Jurors who convicted John...
He is convicted. Joining us from Los Angeles is court reporter Donna Lee Scott. Donna recorded and transcribed depositions from the 1993 accuser and Michael Jackson back in 1995. Welcome, Donna.
Hi, Greta.
Donna, you said first there was the civil case, in which you were not the court reporter, but then some bodyguards sued Michael Jackson, and at that time you were the court reporter, right?
Yes, I was. The allegations on that was a wrongful termination case, actually, and. The guards, their contention was that they knew too much and so they were fired, and the defense was that they were disgruntled employees. And so during that case, we subpoenaed, or my client subpoenaed the mother of the boy, whose name I won't say, even though it's out there, I don't think I should say it, and then the little boy. And Larry Feldman represented the little boy, as you know, and he was, you know, brilliant. So the little boy, in his deposition, he really did not say much, because Larry really didn't let him say much, and my client didn't really want to push on him.
All right. Now, when Michael Jackson was deposed, did he deny the earlier incident with the boy whose name we're not using?
Yes, he did. It took a long time to get into that part of it, because it was talking about Neverland, and the allegation was that the guards would hide children in the guard shack and then sneak them into Michael's room when his parents were asleep, and at one time that Michael had asked one of the guards to go retrieve a picture. And, of course, Michael denied all of that, and... We were taking the deposition from like 10 in the morning until 2. And finally, when it got down to questioning him about not just this boy, but other boys, he got angry. And he actually, Howard Weitzman was representing him, and Howard said, you know, you don't have to answer that. And Michael said, well, I want to answer it. And Howard said, no, don't answer it. And so Michael just stood up. And he turned to everybody and he said, all of you are sick, and he walked out.
What do you think, sitting next to Michael Jackson for those approximately 4 hours of deposition, what was your impression of him?
Actually, at first I thought, oh, I'm going to have so much trouble hearing him, that he's going to giggle and I'm not going to be able to hear him. But actually, he did that a little bit at first, but he was very nice. He was quite charming. And he was a gentleman. They had all this food out for him. They had gummy bears and stuff like that. And I offered him something to drink, something to eat. He didn't take anything in all that time. Then I was worried that he was anorexic or something, but he wouldn't take off his sunglasses. He was wearing his trademark black pants, red shirt, black hat. But he was really charming, and he was nice, and it was actually an amicable setting. There was a lot of laughter, and it was easy. There was a lot of people in the room, and they actually had a video camera going. But he was very nice and very charming, and I could see how, you know, you like him. You just automatically like him.
All right, Donna, thank you. I hope you come back. Appreciate you joining us this evening.
Okay,
let's bring back in the panel. Michael Bryant, do you have any information about whether or not the complainant in this case went to Larry Feldman and there was any effort to get money out of Michael Jackson before these charges were brought?
Well, actually, there's been one question that's bugged me, Greta, since 2 hours after the search warrants were served behind me at these gates. And I broke the story that the kid had gone to an L.A. area attorney and had been rejected. So the one question that bugged me was, as a civil attorney who's evaluated a ton of cases, do I take it, do I not take it? Why not take this case? And in the 2 days since that time, we've seen a zealous D.A. and sheriff with, I guess, great evidence that they think is sufficient to support the charges. So why not take this case civilly? Well, I've learned tonight through sources that I've come to respect that there's a good reason the attorney did not take the case. He's concerned about the credibility of the kid. He was concerned that the story would not be believed by a jury, and they did not take the case.
All right. Bernie, did Michael Jackson get special treatment in the way he surrendered today?
Yeah, I mean, for people who watch the millions who watch the show, justice is purportedly blind, but justice has the towel around the eyes of Lady Justice is torqued just a little bit, because there's justice for the rich and there's justice for the poor. My clients, who really don't have much money, their doors are broken down, their parents are arrested, people are thrown on the floor, there are shock grenades thrown in the house, and then somebody's put under arrest. When somebody's rich and famous gets arrested, and I'm not blaming Michael Jackson and singling him out, I don't think he was going to run, but you know, there's an arrangement made for him to turn himself in. When there's warrants for him, for clients of mine, his name or her name is then entered into what's called the NCIC computer, and that person can be arrested anywhere in the United States just like that, as soon as if they get pulled over on a traffic violation, and then hauled back to Washington, D.C. So, yeah, it's there's justice for the rich, there's justice for the poor.
Steve,
it's unfortunate.
Steve, justice for the rich and justice for the poor. You've represented some high-profile California people.
You know, Greta, I don't agree with the last comment. I've had many clients, not just high publicity clients, but your average client who's gotten charged with something. You're talking to the district attorney, talking to the detective, you're trying to work something out. The detectives don't want to go out and track down your client. If you can make arrangements for a reasonable bail, you bring your client in, they book them, it saves them the hassle, it saves the client of the inconvenience. We're not talking about necessarily wealthy people, we're talking about everyday people who have made arrangements with an attorney in advance. The attorney contacts the authorities, you surrender them. There's no point in going out and arresting them, making a big show out of it. And most of the time, the police and the district attorneys are cooperative. It's in everybody's best interest.
Steve, this happened in less than an hour, the whole process. I got to tell you, here in Washington, D.C., if you ever got out in an hour, you know, it's because you sawed your way out of the joint. I mean, isn't an hour pretty fast?
Yeah, but keep in mind, the Santa Barbara County Sheriff's, they wanted him in and out. It was for their benefit more than his. I mean, you got thousands of media all over the place. They're all clamoring to get pictures. They're disrupting traffic. They're causing all kinds of problems just by their presence. They don't want to create those problems. They want him in and they want him out. This way he's put up his bond. He's out of their hair.
And he was out. And I want to pick on Ted, who's a former homicide detective here, about how here, if you get out in 7, you're lucky. Anyway, panel, thank you very much. And coming up,
people in show business who are telling me that they think that the real story of Michael Jackson is not a pedophile or a bisexual or a homosexual, but an asexual who doesn't manifest himself sexually, either in his sham marriages or even with little kids.
Well, there are
He's
two children now who say
hold on. Listen, we're going to have to go to a break, but coming up, we're going to have a lot more with our legal experts and Michael Jackson's personal friends and ask, should his kids have been taken away from him? He is accused of child molestation. And now, we want to also know how Michael Jackson's high-profile attorney is going to get him out. of this legal mess. That's all coming up straight ahead.
He looks for
civic or authorities still there?
Well, actually, no. We have not seen authorities since the day of the raid, which